I cannot wait to see all that God is going to do today. How about you?
Amen.
Yes. Why don't we open up with a word of prayer? Would you stand with me? Let's stand and just give honor to the Lord. If you want to lift a hand or feel free to pray in the Spirit, pray with understanding, but. God, we just thank you that you're here in the midst of us, Lord. And Father, we stand in your presence today with expectation of your goodness, expectation of your faithfulness, Lord God, expectation, Father God, that today we will be able to stand together and lift the name of Jesus high in this place, and Father, and enter into the very throne room of the King. Father God, we want to stand in your glory today and give you glory today. And so, Father God, as we humbly come before you, God, knowing we're not worthy, God, but we are worth it, we come before you and we just ask that you would be with us in a special way. Meet every need within the sound of my voice, Lord God. Touch our hearts and be with us in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated if you can be. We'll do the upsy-downy thing today. It's fun. Keeps you from getting paralyzed with comfort. And so here we are. There are several things happening over the next several weeks, and most of them are in the bulletin. This afternoon, we're going to have a planning meeting from 12 to 12:30 after church here at the church. It should be short and sweet. What we're doing is we're going to be looking at the Christmas program and trying to figure out how many people want to be involved this year so that we can know how to plan said program. It's always different every time we try to do something with COVID. We never know what sort of participation we're going to have. So we don't want to plan big and have three people show up. We don't want to plan small and have 20 people want to participate. So this meeting is really to kind of get an idea of who wants to be involved. And so if hang around after church and it'll be in the lobby. So we're going to be taking up a special offering during our offering time today to bless Wendy Haynes. We want to bless her. She lost her husband, who was a leader in her community and pastor over at Harvest Church. There's so much that goes on financially when someone passes away, and we just want to ease that part of the burden. It's enough to deal with the loss. Without dealing with the bills. And so we just want to bless her. And so if you feel like participating in that, when we take up our offering, there'll be a basket in the middle, which we're going to give to Wendy. Let's see. We are doing our men's breakfast on November 20th at 7:30 a.m. I haven't talked to Beth. We were planning on doing something different. Oh, there she is. But it's not going to work out for the 20th. So I think we're going to go ahead and do the breakfasts. Okay, good. I love planning during announcements. It's very fun. Be ready in season and out. You never know what pastor's going to ask you to do. And then November 25th, we're going to do a Thanksgiving meal here at the church. We will be advertising for the community. My wife and I want to head this up and just be a blessing to anybody that does not have a place to go for Thanksgiving. It can be a lonely time of year if you have family that is far away or no family at all. And so we've decided that we're going to be doing a Thanksgiving meal here from 1 to 3. If you are interested in participating, whether that's in helping serve or you want to make food or you want to come, we just ask that you RSVP. Let Kimmy know, because she's going to be helping me purchase food and do stuff. And so if you're interested, make sure you touch base with Kimmy and get your name on the list and tell us what you want to do. But we want to serve the community on Thanksgiving this year. My wife and I really feel compelled. We have three sets of parents that we could go visit, and they're all an hour and a half in different directions. So it's actually more fun to stay here. So that's what we're going to do. We have prayer and Bible study Tuesday night at 6. I believe Mel is still doing his Zoom meeting on Monday night at 6:30.
No.
7 o'clock. Okay, and you can get the code from him or online on Facebook. And youth group is happening this week. If you haven't gotten involved in that, it's from 6:30 to 8. We call it Ignite, and it meets here in the gym downstairs. So please feel free, if you are between 12 and 19, you're welcome to come. I think that is it for announcements, but I'm going to have our brother Mel is going to come and do something this morning. It says, thank you for your service, and it has an eagle on it, and it says, integrity, loyalty, duty, respect, honor, courage, and service. And then on the other side, it says, honoring all who served. A veteran is someone who wrote a blank check made payable to the United States of America for an amount of up to and including their life. Amen.
So come forward. Amen.
Yeah. Take a minute. How about a round of applause for our veterans?
In Jesus' name, amen.
Better late than never on the mic, sorry. That was very nice. So we're going to take a minute and take up our tithes and offerings. And so if we could get a couple of our veterans to come, actually, and I guess Bert will help too. Okay, so remember that basket in the middle that Bert is holding is going to be a benefit to help Wendy Haynes and the family with their loss. And so please consider that. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for what we're about to receive on your behalf, Lord God. We ask, Father, that you would bless the gift, multiply it to meet every need, Father God, and also bless the giver. Father, pour out your blessing on those that have, Father, and those that have not. And we ask, Lord, that, Father, that you would be glorified in every way. We thank you, Father, that you give us everything. You give us everything, Lord. And we thank you that we have this opportunity to give back to you. In Jesus' name, amen. So please stand, greet one another in the Lord, and bring your tithes and offerings. Shake a hand. Make sure you're check and make sure somebody wants you to shake their hand. All right, if the worship team wants to come, we're going to get ready to worship the Lord. Hey, guys. Oh, whoa.
Morning, church. How's everyone doing? So yesterday, Ben and I were talking. Hold on. At home, about what separates a Christian from the world, and we were talking more specifically about what was it about Jesus that brought people to him from every walk of life. Both the fancy and the not so fancy. And we're talking about how he was a light and how he was different from the world. And some of the things that we were talking about, like, were his joy, his peace, his self-control, all of the gifts that we can read about in the Bible. And I was thinking about one of the songs we're singing this morning. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5, it says, "For we do not preach ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure of his light in jars of clay, our breakable, not so fancy selves, to show that this all-surpassing power is from God, not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but we're not crushed by it. We're perplexed, which I had to look up what that meant, because I was like, well, I feel perplexed often. But it means we just don't know which direction to go next. We don't know what to do. We're in doubt of what comes next. So we're perplexed, but not in despair. We don't know what to do, but it doesn't bring us to a place of despair. We're persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. For we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that his life may be revealed in our mortal body. So then, death is at work in us, but life is at work in you. And just wanted to remember that today, that as we walk through our daily lives, that we reflect Jesus' attitudes, because that's what attracted people to him. And we reflect Jesus' attitudes, which means that when things are hard, we choose joy over despair. And it's not easy. It's really hard. I'm an emotional person. Ask my two kids and they'll tell you. They're very honest. But sometimes we need a little bit of a reminder that we do trade our sorrows, and we trade our shame, and we lay them down for the joy of the Lord.
Bye.
are hope, you are hope, you have covered all my sins. You are peace, you are peace, when my fear is crippling. You are true, even in my wandering. You are joy.
Thank you. Keeper,
at church? Do you believe that he's the way maker, the miracle worker, the promise keeper? I believe there's a healing anointing right now that God wants to do something. His name is bigger than all other names. All other names of sickness and disease. And we just give an opportunity right now. We feel like the presence of the Lord is here to minister. And if you've got a sickness, specifically cancer, you're dealing with cancer right now, I want you to come up. And we want to pray with you and anoint you with oil, because the way maker is here. The miracle worker is here in our midst. Amen. We're just going to keep on going with that song. Just keep right on rolling through. And the rest of us, just worship. Just worship. But if you're here and you want to see healing happen in your body, I invite you down front. I ask that you put your mask on just to obey the laws of the land. But we want to pray for you. So go ahead, Ben. Mel, if you want to come up. Let's just keep right on rolling.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in. I worship you, 'cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, you're touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, you're turning lives around. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, you're mending every heart. I worship you, I worship you. 'Cause you are worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You're working, even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't likeness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness,
my God, that is who you are. Oh, Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you
for you, the demons run and flee at the mention of your name, King of Majesty. There is no power in hell or
I'm
There's never a time when God does not want to be part of our lives. And it's really a matter of taking the time to acknowledge him. And to be in his presence. I just love coffee. But I love the Lord more. So we are going to let kids go downstairs. There's no middle school class today, so it's just the Little Movers and Mighty Followers. And so I believe Corey's at drill this week, and he'll be back next week. So if you want to open up with me, maybe put one finger in 1 Samuel 17 and one finger in Luke chapter 12. And we're going to be in a couple of different places there. But I don't know about you. I love this time of year. Anybody here love fall?
Yes.
I just enjoy fall. I like it because in the summertime I'm too hot, and in the wintertime I'm too cold. But right now I'm just right. You know what I mean? I'm just right. And I enjoy just about everything about fall except what comes next, and that's the snow. I'm not a big fan of snow. I guess I live in the wrong part of the world. But this is where God has me, and I am blessed to be here. By the way, I want to apologize. I want to just take a second and apologize for something. Last week, you guys appreciated me. And I have to tell you, I am not good at accepting appreciation. And I want to say from the bottom of my heart, thank you. Thank you for thinking of my family, caring about me. I am so blessed and so privileged to be part of this church and to be able to serve you guys. And I sincerely apologize for any reluctance I have had, and God convicted me of that, that I need to let you guys do your thing. So forgive me for that. But anyway, back to fall. I love fall. It's the beginning of hunting season. I love the temperature. You know, spring and fall, the spring's new life. And then fall brings the kind of a close, and then we start over the process. I love everything about it. Fall has the best food. I don't know about you, but I love pumpkin pie, and I love apple pie, and I love the fruits of the season. I love this season. It has the best holidays, Thanksgiving. It's basically a food holiday, which is that's like the joy of my life. I love. You can't tell that I like to eat, can you? Thank you for not noticing. But I do. I love it, and I love everything about it. You know, it's wonderful, but there's also something else about fall that's pretty cool. It's one of my favorite pastimes begins in the fall, and that's football. Anybody here like football?
Amen.
All right, now, I got to be honest with you. I don't like to watch football. I like to play football, and I haven't done that in a long time. But football was one of my favorite things to do. It's something about the camaraderie, something about the collision. Something about it. It's a wonderful, wonderful American pastime, and it traditionally starts in the fall. I've never been a religious football follower, so I couldn't even tell you who plays on what team or any of that good stuff. But I do like it, and we usually throw a Super Bowl party, every year we try to do something like that, but it's really more about the food, again. So at least for our family and the fellowship. And most of the time when we have a Super Bowl party, there's like the kitchen where everybody hangs out and just eats and talks. And then there's like two people in the living room going, yeah, ooh, yeah. And that's a Super Bowl party for us. But when you think about football, you think about, you know, what goes on is basically during this season and all the way through the winter, every Sunday night and or Sunday afternoon, every Monday night, millions of people will come around and watch and they eat lots of food, you know, Tostitos and nachos and all sorts of fun comfort foods. And we get around our TVs or we sit in stands and we sit in relative comfort in our easy boys, lazy boys, watching these people get out onto the field and we sit in extreme comfort and eat comfort food while other people get out onto the field and do something extremely uncomfortable. Has anybody ever noticed the irony of that? They're out there sweating and getting hurt. They're hitting each other with force that will give them concussions, and sometimes they get hauled off the field. They are sometimes playing in the rain or the snow or the mud, and they are uncomfortable. Now, they're having a good time. This is what they love to do. But they are uncomfortable, and we get to sit in our lazy boys and watch this game go on. And I find it very, very interesting that we do this as a culture. We take great pleasure in it. And I've been thinking about this idea that this really could be a picture of the church and Christ. Today, this morning, we sit in very comfortable pews. Hopefully they're comfortable. Everybody feeling comfortable? We sit in comfortable pews and we sing songs of hope and celebration about someone who lived a very uncomfortable life for us. We pray and we cheer on a savior that lived a very uncomfortable life so that we could celebrate and live in victory. And it's a very interesting concept. And we as Christians, particularly in America, have an opportunity to sit in comfort and celebrate a Savior who lived a completely uncomfortable lifestyle. Today I want to make sure that I don't and that you don't miss out on the plan and the purpose of God because we got comfortable in our seats. This is going to be one of those messages that it may be fun for me to preach and maybe not so fun for you to hear. But this is something I think God really wants to speak to us today and speak in the now. Because our culture is becoming more and more about us being comfortable and not getting out and doing anything that is uncomfortable. And I want to challenge you this morning, and I believe that the Lord wants to challenge you this morning to find your purpose, to find your mission, to find your calling, which I guarantee will not be comfortable, and get out of the lazy boy and go get it. Because God wants us to be doing and being part of the call and the mission that He has for us in our lives. Now, I've really enjoyed talking about giants, and I believe that we need to face the giants in our lives in order to reach the calling and the purpose that God has for us. That there are giants that we face that keep us from where God wants us. And I've enjoyed this, but it has been a series that has hit me deeply. Every one of the messages, including this one, is a message that I have had to dig deep and say, wow, you know what, I have to face this giant of fear. I have to face this giant of rejection. And I need Jesus to take care of that. And today, we're going to take a look at the giant of comfort. And the giant of comfort we can find also in this chapter in 17 of 1 Samuel. And I think this is the hardest giant that we'll face. I want you to think about this. When was the last time that someone came up to you and said, you know what, I'm really worried about you because you seem to be doing a little too well. You're looking a little too comfortable. You're looking like, you know what, you were able to take that nice vacation, you were able to, you know, do this thing or that thing, and you look like you're smiling an awful lot, and I got to tell you, I'm worried about you, that you might be suffering from a giant of comfort. That doesn't happen, not in America. We don't do that. No, we worry about other things. But in the reality is, this giant that we're going to be taking a look at is a very sneaky giant. And he comes in when things are good. And oftentimes, God will put us in uncomfortable situations to draw us away from this giant of comfort. I don't remember the last time somebody looked at me and said, you know what, you look too comfortable. And you probably won't ever experience somebody that says this to you. But it's possible that when things are going okay, when we are comfortable, to take the easiest route instead of the hard route, to choose the passive way instead of taking a stand, to say nothing when in our hearts we know we should say something, to do nothing when we know we should do something. And it reminds me of a parable that Jesus told about a man who had a great harvest. And you can find this in Luke chapter 12, if you want to look at it. But in the story, the man had worked hard. He was a farmer, and he had brought in a tremendous harvest, bigger harvest than he'd ever taken in. So big that his barns weren't big enough to collect the harvest. So big that he had to build new barns. And so what he did is he said, you know what, I'm gonna build new barns, I'm gonna take up this harvest. And so he built the new barns and he put the harvest in there and he said, you know what, I'm all set. I'm good for many years. Let's celebrate. Eat, drink, and be merry because things are gonna be good from here. And in that moment, the Lord steps in and says, you fool. Who's going to enjoy this? Because today, you're going to give an account for your life. Today, your soul is required. In verse 20 and 21 specifically, he says, you fool, and I'm not sure, but I believe that there's been times when I've needed that sort of rebuke in my life. And this is never a position that I want to find myself in. But I think as soon as we think we've got it figured it out, as soon as we think that we can live easy, God comes in and says, okay, well, this isn't how I lived. This isn't how I've taught you to live. When we come to that point and God says, you know what? He reminds us that our days are numbered, that there's nothing that we can do to lengthen them or shorten them. God is the author. Jesus is the example. And Jesus did not come to the earth to choose the easiest path, to live the longest, the healthiest life, to have a balanced life, or to skip the hard parts of life and retire in luxury. In fact, he came to do a mission, and when he left us with a mission. Matthew chapter 28, verse 19 says, "Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I'm with you to the very end of the age." And I believe we are approaching, folks, the very end of the age. We're at a place where the world is turning itself upside down. And if we look at the birth pains that Jesus describes, it's a rise of false prophets and teachers, that the love of many believers will grow cold, morals become less accepted, wrong becomes right and right becomes wrong, the people abandoning their Christian faith, famines and droughts and earthquakes and natural disasters, anti-Semitism towards Jews around the world. These are all birth pains of the Lord coming back. These are all birth pains or signs that the day of the Lord is upon us. The parable from Matthew 25 tells us that there were virgins that were preparing for the bridegroom to come. And they brought their lamps. And some of them brought lamps with oil in them, and some of them forgot the oil. That five of them were wise and had everything that they needed, and they were prepared when the bridegroom came. But the bridegroom waited and waited. It seemed like a long time. And they all fell asleep with their lamps. And in the middle of the night, a cry came out, "Oh, the bridegroom comes, the bridegroom comes." And so they go to trim their lamps, and the ones without oil, they didn't have what they needed. And so they had to go and buy oil. And while they were gone, the bridegroom came, and those that were ready went in, and those that were not were stuck outside. And we need to be ready. We need to be ready. We need to have our feet shod with the gospel of readiness, the gospel of truth. We need to be ready. We need to have an answer. And we need to have boots on the ground. I find it interesting. I'm preaching this message with Veterans Day around the corner. And we think about how comfortable we live and how uncomfortable our soldiers are that protect us. In the same way, Jesus lived an uncomfortable way. He took an uncomfortable path to an uncomfortable cross so that we could have the freedom from sin and death and the grave. So if I get into this mindset that I will do this and I will do that and that will set me up to pursue an easy life, and then I'll pursue a calling. Then I'll pursue the purpose that God has for me. Then I'll pursue this thing that I know God wants me to do. We miss the mark. Let me just say that we all need vacations. We all need rest. We all need breaks. That's why God created Sabbath. So that we could rest. And that's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying that we busy ourselves to death doing things for the Lord and miss the calling of God. Because there's a difference between doing things and being in the calling of God. We can busy ourselves to death and miss God's plan and purpose altogether. Because God's plan is also for us to rest. God's plan is also for us to take on exactly what he wants us to take on, not everything else. And so it's not a, you know what, I need to fill this void or I need to do that thing because nobody else is doing it. It's what is God calling you to do? And it's probably an uncomfortable thing. I don't think God's ever called me to do anything that I liked right off the bat. But he has called me to do things that I learned to love. And so I want to challenge you today as we move forward that God is in the middle of the uncomfortable situation in our lives. So I'm not saying you should never take a rest or a vacation, or you should fill up your schedule with many religious things that keep you exhausted all the time, but what you should always have is a vision for where God is taking you next, who God wants to reach next, what he wants you to do next. When we lose sight of that, we run the risk of saying, well, I'll go to church. I would go to church, but the couch is more comfortable. We say, you know what, I would do this, but that would make me uncomfortable. I would say this at work, but that might make things uncomfortable. We might be a little bit more hesitant to do what God is calling us to do. What we want to avoid is setting up a life that is pain-free and comfortable, all while enjoying and celebrating a Savior who lived the opposite. Jesus' model of life was full of suffering and difficulty, a life that was full of hard roads and less desirable company and ministry that meant going out of his way and that cost him something every time. In fact, when we take a look at the totality of Scripture, let me ask this question, maybe you can answer it. Who was it that lived an easy life and followed the calling of God? Anybody? Nobody. None of the prophets. None of the people in the Old Testament. None of the people in the New Testament. Everybody struggled every step of the way. And God was with them through it. I want you to think about this. The Holy Spirit is not a spirit of comfort. He is the comforter, the great comforter. Okay? And in order to need a comforter, you have to be in a situation that is uncomfortable. Do you understand what I'm saying? In order to receive ministry from the Holy Spirit, you're going to need to be uncomfortable. There is this theme throughout Scripture that Jesus says we need to understand this, that life is uncomfortable and ministry is more uncomfortable. And our walk with God is never easy. Wow, I am all over my notes today. That's why Paul told us in Romans chapter 12. He says, therefore, I urge you, brothers, sisters, in the view of God's mercy, to go to church once in a while on Sunday. It's holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Isn't that what he says? Was there something wrong with that? No. That's not what he said. He says, therefore, I urge you, my brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable or pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Paul is expecting it to be difficult. It's not a sacrifice if it's easy. It's not a sacrifice if it doesn't cost me something. But I'll tell you what, God doesn't give us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. So, why does he do that? Why does he give us a spirit of power, love, and a sound mind? Why? Anybody? This is a real question, looking for a real answer. Yeah, he gives us a spirit of power, love, and a sound mind so that we can take it out and use it, which is uncomfortable. And I need the spirit of power, love, and a sound mind in order to be able to do that. I can't bottle it up and keep it home. And so when we're taking a look at these scriptures and we're going to take a look at this giant of comfort and how this plays together, but we have to wrap our heads around this idea. And it's not a popular idea. I get it. You know, Pastor, whoa, this is a great message. I'm so uplifted today. There's going to be suffering in my life. Thank you for letting me know. But the reality is, this is the truth. And the truth is never easy. But it's always good. And I want you to get a hold of this concept. Because for the most part, we get comfortable with our routine. We get comfortable with our sweet, beautiful, personal Savior who died publicly and naked on a cross by the hands of wicked men. And it would be easier for us to not share him, to not live for him, to not follow the purpose and plans for our life, than it would be for us to do it. You know, the word tells us that we have been given a spirit not of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. It doesn't tell us that we've been given a spirit of confusion, a spirit of laziness, a spirit of latida. He called us to be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Why? Because it's not easy. Because God desires that the people of God would stand strong behind the champion and to take the land for the kingdom. So he takes the giant of fear out, and he takes out the giant of rejection in our life. But Jesus doesn't really slay the giant of comfort. This is something we've got to do. And we can do it because we know we're supposed to. And we can do it because we know we have calling and purpose. But this sneaky giant will sneak in and say, not today, tomorrow. Not now, later. And we are encouraged to wait until it's a little easier. To wait until the culture isn't so hostile. To wait until COVID is over. To wait to reach because right now it's uncomfortable. To wait to fulfill that calling and that purpose because right now it doesn't seem like the perfect time. Do you get what I'm saying? And this isn't an easy message. I understand that. And it'll get funner in a minute, I promise. Everything's better with coffee. And here's the thing. When we miss the purpose of our calling, when we miss the mission of our Savior, we'll always settle at the feet of the giant of comfort. David didn't struggle with this giant. And during this time in his life, you know, at least not during this time in his life, but you know who did? Is Saul. Saul dealt with this giant most of his life. And several times in 1 Samuel, we see Saul fails to obey the word of the Lord to fulfill the specific mission that God has given him before the Lord anoints David the king. And so Saul is the king of Israel. He's the first king of Israel. And God has chosen him and appointed him. And then in chapter 13, we see that Saul fails to wait for the prophet to bring the sacrifice before he goes to war. And so rather than waiting for Samuel to arrive, he offers the sacrifice himself, and he loses God's approval. And then in chapter 14, he swears an oath out of pride that almost gets Jonathan, his son, killed for the price of eating a little bit of honey when somebody said not to. And then in chapter 15, he does not follow the Lord's command to kill all the Amalekites when they go to war. And the anointing of the Lord leaves him. And from that point on, he's tormented by this spirit. And he's constantly seeking one thing. What do you suppose that is? Comfort. In this place of falling away from God's calling and his anointing, the rest of his life he seeks after one thing, comfort. But he finds none. We find him calling David to soothe his spirit by playing the harp. We find him seeking mediums after Saul's death to give him comfort about going to war. And in fact, in chapter 17, when David stands up to fight Goliath, where is Saul? Saul is in his tent, eating cheese and bread, probably brought by somebody else. This is interesting how this standoff between Israel and the Philistine works out. And the story opens with the Philistine taunting Israel, but remember what it says in chapter 17, verse 16. It says, for 40 days, everybody say 40 days. Okay, get that into your mind. 40 days. Do you know how long 40 days is? I quarantined for 10, and I almost died. Okay, like 10 days is a long time. 40 days. 40 days is a long time to be sitting in a tent. All right, 40 days. That's 80 opportunities, because it says he came out twice a day to taunt Israel. Twice a day. Okay, that means twice a day the Philistine presented himself 80 opportunities over 40 days, and no one, not even Saul the king, did anything. And then in a matter of less than a few minutes, David solves a problem that in 40 days the whole army of Israel couldn't do. Saul, who was a head and shoulders taller than every other Israelite in the land, who was an experienced warrior, who had killed his fair share of giants, because the Amalekites were giants too. Most of the Ites had giants. Saul, who was strong, who was the king, the leader of Israel, he was the obvious one who should have faced the giant and honestly had the best chance of killing it. But why would he instead stay on the hill? Why would he and all of the Israelite army stay on the hill? I'll tell you why. Because they had tents. Because they had food. Because they had Davids bringing them provisions. Because they were comfortable. And the battlefield, that was not a comfortable place to be. Why step forward when my tent is warm? There are others that can step up because they face a giant that said it's uncomfortable to be out here in the field, but there's comfort on the hill. It's very uncomfortable to be down in the field. There's a fire that you can sit around near the tents, but in the valley it's cold. There's no resupply. And there are giants that want to fight. So Saul chooses to stay back rather than to step into the calling that was on his life. Maybe Saul was scared. Maybe Saul felt rejected by Samuel. Maybe Saul was fighting what God was doing. But I believe that Saul, who had the size, who had the best armor, the best weapons, who had the best training, who had the most experience, who was the leader of the army of Israel, could have easily dealt with the giant, but he had fallen asleep at the wheel. He had become comfortable waiting for God to intervene. Saul likely had slipped into the mentality that I have enough, I have all the supplies I need, and I'll wait until a different season to find the purpose of God. I can obey God in another chapter of my story. I'll take a risk when my barns are more full or my bigger barns are built. I'll take a step of faith when it seems more convenient or less uncomfortable. And God is saying to us right now, don't let comfort be the thing that causes you to miss God's purpose for your life. Don't let it be the thing that causes you to miss the reward for being faithful to your calling. So here's the big idea. Our faith actually thrives in discomfort. Our faith thrives when we're uncomfortable. That's why God often chooses discomfort for us, because we often won't choose discomfort for ourselves. And we won't find the purpose of God in our comfort. So God chooses difficult places in our lives to reveal himself to us. God has a model for us to choose the most uncomfortable place. And for him, he chose the most uncomfortable place in history to show us how to live. He chose the cross on Calvary as a method to giving us salvation and faith and hope that we need. Why? Because in the middle of the difficulties of life, God always shows up if we look for him. It was never when the Israelites had the numbers or had the advantage or when the men could take credit. It was always when men would have no hope or no choice that God would show up, because that's when he would receive the glory. I recently heard a story of a missionary that was in a hostile country. It was a short-term missions person. And they went to this place. I don't remember where it was. It might have been China. And he was talking to a person that was a Christian, and he said, "You know what, I want to go and I want to worship with you. I want to go to whatever meeting you're going to." And he said, "Yeah, sure, we'll do that." And he said, "Do we go to a church or someone's house?" And he said, "Well, you know, I'm not going to tell you where, but why don't you meet me at the mall where I work, and after work I'll take you there." And so he went to the mall, and the guy works in a department store, and he says, "Just hang out. We're going to close in a few minutes, and I got a couple things to do." And so he hangs out, and he goes and locks the door, and he said, "Okay, well, come back with me to the stock room. I've got a couple things left to do in the stock room, and then I'll take you to where we're going to worship." And so they step back into the stock room, and they pulls back the curtain in the stock room, and in the stock room there are several dozen Christians huddled in the stock room around a TV, and that's where they were holding service, in a crowded little stock room, and they were worshiping to music played on a television and listening to a word over the television, because that's the only way that they could do it, because none of them had Bibles. And what was interesting about this story, and what dawned on the person telling it, was when we think about life in America and we think about life in these other countries, in these hostile environments, who do we think has a more hunger or desire or a passion to pursue a relationship with Jesus. We who can come into a comfortable building, it is a little warm in here, but we who can come into a comfortable building and sit in a comfortable pew, or somebody that's huddled in a stockroom without a Bible, just trying to get a message that will get them through the next day. We have such privilege. We have such comfort in that privilege that oftentimes we miss the calling. Somebody else will step up. Somebody else will do it. Somebody else will find the purpose. I can do it in another season. And this giant of comfort comes in and says, wait till later. And the next thing you know, there is no later. It's gone by. Faith flourishes in hostile territory. We in America don't understand the hostilities of persecution and hardship that comes in all sorts of ways. We may find it easier to pray when something is on the line. We may find it easier to pray when someone is sick or when something is broken in our lives. So I ask you, how comfortable are you today? Israel had become comfortable just waiting for the problem in front of it to go away. Saul had become comfortable. Israel had decided that rather than go and fight, they would retreat back to the comfort of their tents and their bread and cheese, and they were comfortable not winning the fight as long as they did not have to risk anything, as long as they didn't have to work to deal with the issue. They had decided that they were comfortable sitting on the sidelines. David may have defeated Goliath, but it was the army of Israel that defeated the Philistines. Everybody that was there was capable of stepping forward. Everybody was there, and it took one person stepping up to say, you know what? I'm going to go do the uncomfortable thing. I'm going to go do this thing. They could have done it. They had faced their fears, and if they'd faced their fears and doubts, they could have done it if they did not fear grief or pain. They could have done it if they were not scared of facing the rejection of those that thought that they shouldn't. And all these things caused them to step back when God was moving forward. The problem that we face is that too many of us have said, we'll wait. We'll wait to take our community until the giant leaves. Maybe if we wait, our problems will hopefully get better. Maybe if we stay home until the virus goes away. Maybe when things calm down, I'll go back to church or start something or do something to reach my community, my loved ones, my workplace. Maybe when things are not so hostile in their culture, I'll share my faith. Maybe when things are not so politically charged, I'll take a stand. Maybe when my barns are full, I'll have more to give. But right now, I'm comfortable. I'm committed to what I'm doing. I'm comfortable with my work. I have a balance in life. I don't want to disrupt things. I don't want to make people hostile. That would be uncomfortable. And if I share and they disagree, that would make things awkward. This is where Saul fails. This is where we often fail. And so the question is, how do we slay the giant of comfort in our lives? And I'll give you three quick things, and then we're going to pray. But David does three things, and I think there's three mindsets that we can get a hold of here. Most of the time, the thing that God is doing will not be comfortable, and I should not expect it. And I think that's something that David understood, that the battlefield is not going to be a comfortable place, that what we are going to be asked to do or required to do is not going to be comfortable. Stepping out will never feel just right. Whether it's singing a song publicly, being used in a gift at church, learning a new skill, or sharing my faith, it never starts out comfortable. David didn't get up one morning and say, "I guess I'll go kill a bear today." Yeah, sounds like a good idea. I mean, maybe he did, but I mean, I've done that. I've gone out looking for a bear. I never found one. But David didn't get up in the morning and say, "You know what? I'm gonna overcome a lion today." He got up and he faced his day with calling and purpose. I'm going to protect the sheep. I'm going to do what God has called me to do. And when the bear came along, it was not a problem. David could have run. That's what I would do if I was just walking along and a bear showed up, unless I was carrying. It is an uncomfortable thing to face a bear. But if we are responsible in the small things, God will give us greater things. David was responsible with the bear. He was responsible with the lion. And so Goliath was not a thing that he was worried about. Number two, most of the time, I'll have to step forward out of comfort alone. Knowing that it's only God that's with me. At this moment in history, David was a shepherd who took a few steps and became the captain of the army of Israel. If David doesn't take those steps alone with God, he'll never lead the army of Israel. He'll never fulfill his calling. I want you to really wrap your head around this. You will be asked to step up in some way by God. And in that moment, you're going to hear God's still voice. You've got to step up to do it. You have to step away from the giant of comfort and do it. It will not be comfortable. Maybe it's something as simple or complicated, depending on how you look at it, as being used in a gift of the Spirit, being asked to pray for somebody for healing, and have to exercise your faith. Maybe it'll be something as maybe a little more out there as sharing the gospel with your coworker that sits in the cubicle next to you, or sharing with your cousin or your aunt or whoever. Maybe it'll be something as complicated as leading a ministry or doing something bigger than what you've ever thought you could do. It will be uncomfortable until you do it. And then God will put something even more uncomfortable in your life and it won't look so bad. You'll realize that was just the bear. Wait till the lion. You'll realize that was just the lion. Wait till the Goliath. And so I want to challenge you and encourage you that most of the time the thing that God is going to ask you to do will not be comfortable, and I shouldn't expect it. Most of the time I'll have to step out alone. And lastly, most of the time to follow God, I'll have to risk something or sacrifice something. To follow Christ, you might have to give up your tent, your comfy place, your safety, because you can only carry so much. David was offered the best armor in the land, the best sword, but he wasn't able to do that. He didn't know how to use that stuff. So he took his sling and a stone, and he faced a giant. We're going to be in situations where God is going to call us to do things that are very uncomfortable. And maybe he's already doing it. Maybe you're sitting here today and you're saying, "You know what? God has been speaking to me for a while to do this thing, and I have put it off. I've thought there'll be a better time. I want to challenge you to step up and do what God wants you to do. Will you stand with me? We're going to pray and close out the service. But, and I know this is not the funnest giant to face, but this one is our giant to face. This one is one that only I'm going to face. Jesus doesn't kill this one for you, because this giant is the giant of the flesh. Most of the time when we face a giant that is fleshly, it has to do with comfort and stepping out of what we know we're capable of. And so as we pray today, I want to just ask you to be honest with yourself. Do I have vision? Do I have purpose? Am I on mission? And if I'm not, am I too comfortable to see it? It's just being honest. You know, and you don't have to tell me, okay? We're not going to take a, well, yeah, no, I'm way off, Pastor, it's me. You've been talking to me all day. No, I don't need that. This is an opportunity for you to just get before the Lord for a minute and say, you know what, God, I want to be on mission. I've gotten too comfortable. Help me slay this giant. Can we do that together? Lord, I'll speak for me. There's areas in my life I've gotten too comfortable. There are places in my life where, God, I've let a giant come in and lull me to sleep in my walk. And so, Father, I pray you would just awaken us in your spirit. Father, raise up the warrior, the spirit of the warrior in this congregation. Father God, I know you have plans and you have purpose for this congregation, God. For every person within the sound of my voice, God, you desire for them to walk into uncomfortable situations and receive victory. And so, God, today we put to rest the giants of comfort in our lives. Father God, I put to rest those areas where I've said, you know what, I'm not going to do that because it's uncomfortable, or I don't feel like the timing is right, or I'll wait until it's easy. I put that away right now. And God, I ask that you would give wisdom, that you would put us on mission, that you would give us purpose and calling, and that in the power of the Holy Spirit, we could go forth and share the gospel throughout the land. Not worried about what others think. Not worried about what's easy or comfortable. But God, following your example, Lord, let us take up our crosses and follow you. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, I believe that there is great purpose coming. I want you to get a hold of this. There is great purpose coming. And I want to challenge you to slay the giant of comfort in your life and be ready to get your hands dirty. Okay? Love you so much. Have a wonderful day. Yeah, we got about 15 minutes, so use the bathroom. And if you're staying because you want